Log4j is a very popular logging library for Java, so a critical vulnerability in there is bad. And that's what we got for Christmas. So nice. You probably have seen the Log4Shell payload and how to test for the vulnerability everywhere. And I'm telling you now, this payload will go down in the history books like the shell shock snippets, and I expect to see it on t-shirts at the next conference I visit. Anyway, I thought for a while if I should make a video about the apocalyptic Log4j vulnerability or not. On one hand, I know a video about this topic will be popular, but on the other hand, the internet is full of good resources about it already, and I don't want to just copy and paste what other people already have written about and repackage it in video form. If I do a video, I want to provide a bit more in-depth information or share a unique perspective. And I think I have that now. I hope with this video I can clear up some confusions about it, look a layer deeper into it, and share some general thoughts about what you can learn from all of this. I have a lot of thoughts, so this video will come in two parts. But before we start, I have a public service announcement. Give it away. To all my bug bounty hunters, when you hunt for Log4j messages, make sure you actually confirm the vulnerability. For example, when you write an email in Gmail with a JNDI payload, you actually get a DNS pingback. And you might believe you confirmed the issue, but actually you did not. In this case, it's just Google scanning the URL for spam detection reasons. So to actually confirm if the Log4j injection is real, always add a nested lookup, for example, the Java version, and try again. If it were really a Log4j vulnerability, you would get a DNS ping to XXX, the Java version, XXX, and the long domain. But if we check the pingback we receive now, we only get XXX. So this confirms that there is no Log4j lookup happening. This is not a vulnerability in Google. And I know every bug bounty program is getting swarmed with reports these days. And for the sanity of the triagers, please confirm your bugs before reporting blindly. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much. Let's head in. Let's start with the basics. Chapter 1, Log4j. I wanted to briefly introduce you to Log4j and some basic features that really help to understand the bigger picture. So here's a simple Java example using Log4j. We get a logger instance and we can then call logger.info to log a message. Besides this, Log4j can be heavily configured. Here's a very, very basic log4j2.xml config file. And in here, we say that we have a logger that logs anything starting with the log level info to a target we called console. And console is actually referring to the target standard system out. So when we run the program, we see the log message in the terminal. But you could also here define that the logs are supposed to be written or appended to a file, or even sent away to a remote logging service. Also, here we can specify the log message format. We have in brackets percentage %t, which says we want the thread name here, and percentage %m is the actual message. And at the end, we have percentage %n, which is the line termination, so a new line. There are many patterns available, like we could add date and time information, or the name and line of the Java file where the logging happened. And this leads us to another Log4j feature. Lookups. Most of the lookups are fairly innocent. For example, the env lookup allows us to add environment variables in the log message. So if we wanted to print the current home directory, we can just write $ and then in curly braces env colon home, and Log4j will then replace this. And so there are various different lookups. For example, the Java version, or if we run in a Docker container, you can log the container name. You can see that this is useful information you maybe want to include in your log messages. And now you probably wonder what the JNDI lookup is for, because that is the one used in the exploit. Chapter 2, JNDI. Well, the purpose of JNDI is basically to do the same. It's there to look up some information to be included in the log message. But JNDI is a lot more complex and powerful than just environment variables, because it is used to fetch information from a remote server. Let's do an example how this could be used. Let's say you have multiple apps that connect to the same database, and somehow you have to configure the database address in all of them. You could hard code it, but that's not great when you do local development and then you want to run it in production, really messy.
Alternatively, you could have a config XML file with the address in it, or how it is very common in web hosting, you set it with environment variables. But that still requires to make sure all of the information is set correctly on all systems. Why not centralize this information? So in the case of very enterprisey Java, you could use a server that stores this config. This could be an LDAP server, and it can be accessed with JNDI, the Java naming and directory interface. So now when any app is running and wants to know the database to connect to, it can ask with JNDI, the LDAP server, where the database server is. Great. At least that's one use case I can imagine what to use JNDI for. I'm not too familiar with enterprise Java deployments and don't know how it actually is used. Anyway, let's come back to logging. It makes sense that if you are generally using JNDI, maybe you want to log such a value as well. And so the JNDI lookup of data in some LDAP server is a nice feature. So now we understood the general usage of Log4j, we learned about Log4j lookups and what JNDI can be used for. Now we can already better understand the vulnerability, because it's important to understand that JNDI has nothing to do with Log4j. JNDI is a Java thing to get values from a remote server like LDAP. And Log4j has various lookup features with those curly braces, and one of those happens to be the feature to perform JNDI lookups. And that's very important to keep in mind. On one side, we have Log4j supporting various lookups, and on the other side, we have JNDI, which is supported as one of the features of Log4j lookups. Makes sense, right? So we covered some basic. Let's talk about the Log4Shell vulnerability. Chapter 3, Log4Shell Timeline. On the 10th of December, Apache published an advisory for CVE-2021-44228 with an update for Log4j. Unlike some of the internet believe, it was not first discovered in Minecraft. This issue was first discovered by Chen Jiajun of the Alibaba cloud security team. I'm sorry for the pronunciation. I believe it was reported around the 26th of November, so there were about 2 weeks from report to disclosure. But let's go back further in time to understand how this vulnerability came to be. In 2013, a feature patch was submitted to Log4j to add JNDI lookups. As we have heard, could be a cool feature. But this was actually the introduction of the vulnerability, so it was there for like 8 years. In 2014, there was a funny but interesting issue submitted. Somebody wanted the ability to disable date lookups completely because of compatibility issues with other libraries. This issue highlights the problem of intransparent and hidden magical features of libraries. Here, a developer was trying to log a string that looks like a valid Log4j lookup, but it was not. They literally wanted to log this string, but then Log4j tried to resolve this as a date lookup and threw exceptions. And this was a surprise to the developer, and so they asked for a feature to disable the lookups. Log4j lookups are well documented in the documentation, but not everybody who uses Log4j knows all of this. So it's an unexpected behavior from the point of view of a regular developer. And here is the first lesson we can learn. When we plan to build secure libraries, we have to think about the expectations of developers. And developers expect they log string messages and that there is not much fancy stuff done with it. And if we still want to offer those fancy features, it's best to put them behind an opt-in configuration. This allows power users to make use of it, but people with just basic logging requirements don't use more than what they need. Anyway, the issue report actually led to the implementation of a new feature, %m no lookups. This can be put into the Log4j config file here in the pattern layout, and this tells Log4j when you log a message, ignore the lookups. If you now try a lookup, you see it's not resolved. So let's fast forward to 2017. A Log4j maintainer added a new config option, format message no lookups, which generally disables lookups globally. This now also applies to only %m, so you don't have to replace and configure all log messages with %m no lookups anymore. Both of these features have been recommended as a first mitigation of the issue. Without upgrading Log4j, people could just add this to their logger configs and be safe. However, this mitigation was later redacted because it's not perfect. I think it's generally an okay mitigation, but there are some caveats you should be aware of, but more on that in part 2. Anyway, After 2017, it took a few years, and finally in 2021 we get an advisory about the remote code execution using the JNDI LDAP lookup. And it's crazy, even the German government issued an IT emergency of state 4 red. This means the IT threat situation is very critical, outage of many services is likely, and the live operation of services cannot be guaranteed. It's insane. There's also some interesting data from Cloudflare. Cloudflare is proxying web requests for tons and tons of sites over many, many years. So if somebody has data on historic use of this exploit, then it could be Cloudflare. And they said the first usage they found was on the 1st of December. This is kind of interesting because it's 9 to 10 days before public disclosure, but all of this is no surprise to me. Researchers often share their findings with friends, you know, the cool hacker underground, the scene. There are groups of people that just like to share their research, progress, and bounce ideas around. So to me, it's really no surprise that this slowly leaked through some cracks. It's to be expected, I think, and nothing to be really concerned about. But it's also good to see that nobody seemed to have known about this vulnerability for years and kept it secret. So that's the timeline. But wait a minute, that's not the complete timeline. There is a significant point missing in this history. Actually, there happened something important in 2016. Let's talk about JNDI and LDAP exploitation. In 2016, there was a talk at Black Hat by Pwntester and Oleksandr Mirosh, a journey from JNDI LDAP manipulation to remote code execution dreamland. In this talk, they presented research into JNDI and specifically the LDAP and RMI features. It turns out that you can basically store Java serialized objects in LDAP, and then a JNDI lookup is not just looking up a basic string, but maybe a complex Java object. And this is where we enter the world of arbitrary code execution. In the Java development world, people love to send complete objects over the network. Even in my Java computer science class at university, when we covered networking and sockets, we made examples with object input stream and then read object. It's super easy to just transmit complete objects through the network between Java applications. It's a very powerful feature, but this has massive security problems. Java objects have functions, constructors, and so forth with code that can run. So if an attacker can send arbitrary serialized objects to an application, then you likely get remote code execution. And in a bigger Java application, this is very common, especially in applications that are generally ran in internal enterprise networks. I also guess most Java remote code execution CVEs are the result of arbitrary object deserialization or class loading, that kind of stuff. There are also Java features to restrict what these serialized objects can do. There is the Java Security Manager where you can set certain policies to prevent or sandbox arbitrary code execution. But yeah, this whole object serialization and remote class loading is a Java feature. Developers will use it, and so apps will be vulnerable. Anyway, it's important to understand that this talk is generally about JNDI and the remote class loading with LDAP and RMI, and I'm not covering this much more in this video. So if you want to know more about their research, watch the talk and read their white paper. But what's important for me to highlight is that this whole research has nothing to do with Log4j. It is just a talk about security researchers looking at a particular Java feature, JNDI. And they simply ask themselves, if somebody could control JNDI lookups, what could go wrong? And they found out it can lead to remote code execution. And so this is very interesting because at the time, in 2016, this talk and research was not that interesting. I mean, on the surface, it's just more examples of Java object deserialization stuff, which we see a lot. At least that is my feeling as somebody who is not deep in the Java world. But now in 2021, we know that this is exactly what is exploited in Log4j. Suddenly, this research is the most important puzzle piece of the Log4Shell vulnerability. Anyway, we should be wondering, how can it be that in 2016, at one of the biggest and most important security conferences, world-class researchers clearly said applications should not perform JNDI lookups with untrusted data because it leads to remote code execution. And it took 5 years for somebody to realize that this can be exploited in one of the most popular logging libraries. What was the problem? Security research versus software engineering. There are two questions we could ask ourselves. First, why did Java developers that know about Log4j and JNDI lookups, or even the Log4j maintainers themselves, not know about this threat, which was publicly shared at a well-known security conference? And the second question is, why did Pwntester or we, the whole security community, not realize that the JNDI research can be abused in Log4j? Alvaro Munoz, aka Pwntester, who did the talk at Black Hat, shared this tweet. If developers don't know that untrusted data should not be passed to a JNDI lookup, then we as a security community have failed them. It's not their fault. And he is absolutely right. I think it's awesome to have developers who try to stay up to date on security research. And if you are a developer watching right now, I hope my channel helps you with that. But to be honest, we, the security community, use the term security. We should be the ones who should have recognized the impact. I mean, we did, the Alibaba cloud security team did, but a bit late in 2021. So this is a perfect example why I think it's so important for any security researcher and pen tester and whatever to understand how applications are built, having development experience. I think this is a great example of the security community failing to understand how apparently every bigger Java application is built. This research in 2016 was so important for the Java landscape, and nobody recognized that earlier. That's a bit embarrassing for us. Unfortunately, the security community and the developer community are very separate, and that makes sense. While the fields are very related, in both of them you have more than a lifetime of information to consume. So it's easy to say, don't be so separate, but I don't know how we could solve that. I hope my YouTube channel is popularizing creative security thinking, but lots of work to be done in the area, and I hope we can somehow improve it. And with those final thoughts, we have reached the end of part one of this two-part series. Next time, we will dig deeper into the code of Log4j, talk about secure code design, and so if you are a developer, please watch the next video as well. We will also bridge the gap to related vulnerabilities like format string vulnerabilities, and we discuss the mitigation that later was redacted. For now, thanks so much for watching. I would really appreciate if you can share this video with your friends and colleagues, and maybe check out liveoverflow.com/support. See you in part two. Peace.